Joe Walsh and Tammy Duckworth. I am a resident of the 8th District, but I'm also Vice President of Outreach for 527 Group, the National Atheist Party. We represent the, or hope to represent the interest of, you know, it's 16 to 22%, depending on how you count non-believers. And it's not just issues of separation of church and state. We also value evidence-based conclusions about public policy. We have secular humanist values. So initially, I just have a general question. How will you represent atheist voters of this district?
I mean, I think I would represent them the same way I represent everyone else. I'm not going to be picking and choosing or favoring any one constituent based on their religion or their creed or their color or their sexual orientation or anything like that. If you're a constituent of the 8th District, you will be entitled to every bit the representation that anyone else will.
Maybe two issues that might be specific, because I was trying to ask a follow-up. Two issues might be the recent apology offered for the burning, and you made reference to that, of the Quran in Afghanistan, and then the reaction to that, and our release of an apology, and also our kind of lack of a response to the actions that have happened afterwards. And another one might be in fiscal policy. You've kind of talked about the loopholes, and the recent state issue was talking about here is us offering the exemption to Sears, or basically renewing their exemption to pay any taxes in here. And then Quinn just released a budget, you know, that we have to make hard cuts, and that's obvious. But part of this, our values is where we place our money, and that we're going to close down mental health institutions. Our prison system right now, we currently house about 50,000 for prisons that are meant to hold about 34,000 or 36,000, and now we're going to close down two more prisons. So it's kind of like we'll give these exemptions to Sears, or we'll cut these services, which have a direct effect. So the issue is more about respecting issues, separating church and state. It's about rationality and public policy, mm-hmm. and humanist values.
Yeah, I mean, I think I'm not sure how the latter issue relates to maybe your platform on the atheist party, but the way I look at a couple of the issues you brought up is that I don't think that they have to do with religion. I don't think they have to do with your spiritual beliefs. I think they are secular, civil issues that we have to discuss in a rational way, based on evidence. And so that's how I would approach it. With regard to the Quran burning, I do want to address that very briefly because it's very much in the news. I'm not sure what Joe Walsh said.
I didn't ask about that. I asked him a general question, and I specifically asked Joe Walsh because he has a 0% rating from Secular Coalition for America, which means he was the only. There was a lot of high. Yeah, he scored lower than John Shimkins, who believes you don't need to worry about climate change because God promised Noah that he would never flood the earth again. He scored lower. He scored 0%. So every single bill was brought up. Some of them had to do with the ungodly trust vote. Some of them were specific exemptions for retirement funds. One was one of the bills that Joe Walsh voted against was actually offering a representative to go over to other foreign countries and preach tolerance and acceptance of other religions, which is something that we had obviously supported. Secular Coalition for America, which is a different group, support as well. And he was the only one that Illinois had voted against.
Yeah, I think Bob wants to.
Can I just two things? One is the people that talk about religion and the U.S. and a quote-unquote a Christian country, never read the Constitution. There's only two provisions in the Constitution. One says that, it shall not be a condition of electability or appointability to any federal office, which, by the way, is always violated by the senators who ask the prospective appointees of the Supreme Court about their visions on abortion. That's a violation of that. Second thing is, the First Amendment says, shall restrict no religion nor endorse any religion. And the people that talk about that's all there is in the Constitution, those two provisions, nothing else. Second thing is, when you talk about the burning of the Qurans, I heard something today from somebody who knew about it. He said, first of all, the Qurans that were burned came from a prison where they were marking them as communication between the prisoners. And when you have somebody like Karzai, who won't even get up and denounce the burning of of the girls' schools, and of some of the mosques, which, of course, not only do they lose all the lights, but they lose the Korans in there. It doesn't say a thing about that. This is all put up. And the point is, there does or should become a point where we realize there is no way in the world with these people that you're going to affect any kind of representative government.
What are your views on legalizing marijuana?
Whoa.
That was a break here.
That's serious.
Come on. He's like this guy here. He was Joe Walsh and that guy was an atheist.
Can I ask you a question here? Is that okay with you?
Fine.
No, I can't answer that question.
Oh, yeah, okay. He's the guy.
Okay, so it's my opinion that with regard to marijuana, I think what Tony Preckwinkle has done at the county level is starting to make sense, more and more sense, which is maintaining marijuana possession and distribution and dealing as an offense, but not one that warrants jail time. And from her standpoint, there were at least two reasons why she went down that path. One is that her jails are full. Cook County jails are completely full, and the people that have to be in prison, you know, are violent offenders and so forth. We're starting to have a problem in placing them in these prisons, and so that's one reason. Secondly, they're not getting the treatment that they require, and so what she decided to do was go from jailing these people to making it a misdemeanor offense. Punishable by fines and requiring treatment and community service. And I think that recognizes both our fiscal challenges as well as the fact that, you know, these people require treatment. They don't necessarily require jail time, especially in a time when we need those slots for, you know, violent offenders. Mm-hmm. So I think that's probably the approach that makes the most sense to me over time. But I'd be open to hearing what other people say on this too.
Well, my thought is legalize it and tax it, and you solve a lot of your problems with the income that's not coming in right now.
I think
at the federal level, at the state level, at the local level.
Yeah. I mean, I'll tell you what the argument is on the other side, which you've heard. I'm sure that you've all heard this, which is that when you legalize marijuana, you will increase its consumption.
Absolutely.
And so. There are a lot of people who have a problem with that. There are a lot of people who believe that it's a gateway to other criminal acts. Certainly a lot of law enforcement believes that. And so I think that we have to look carefully at this issue, but I like what President Preckwinkle is doing because I think it's practical and it's also principled, which I think is the right way to go right now. Sir?
What's your feelings on importation of drugs? I know Joe Welch, he claims that, you know, they don't have control over the purity of the drugs, but there's a lot of money,
I know,
that can be saved.
Absolutely. I believe that, for instance, we should be able to import prescription drugs at least from Canada. I mean, that's a no-brainer. It's something that's specifically barred or prohibited under the Medicare Part D Act. In 2003, Big Pharma lobbied successfully for that prohibition. Just like they lobbied successfully for the bar on negotiating for prescription drugs under Medicare.